and welcome back to my channel. Today's video is something that came to me very last minute, the video topic, and even more last minute, I invited my dad, aka Dr. Ron Smith, to come and talk with me about this subject because he is one of the main people that kind of have influenced my opinion on this with what he's learned through many years of being a marriage counselor, relational counselor, and pastor. Mm-hmm. So today we will actually be addressing the topic of should Christians date to marry, and did the church get this wrong whenever they kind of formed this opinion for us over the past few years. So should we date to marry? No is kind of the answer that we've come to, and it's mainly because of a lot of reasons, one of them being you should date with intentionality and wisdom, but you shouldn't date to marry because of the unnecessary pressures that can be put on a person in a relationship early on if you like come at it with the expectation that you're gonna marry them. Along with something else that my dad pointed out that I first wanna address is just social skills and how that plays into dating and prepping you for marriage. So Dad, you wanna tackle that topic?
Yeah, I mean, it's funny, when I was first called into ministry, one of the very first conferences I actually attended was a conference by Dr. Gary Chapman, who now has written the five love languages. This was before the book ever came out. And I felt kind of weird because I was single and my pastor said, you need to come to this marriage conference. And I thought, I'm going to feel really out of place here. And I did, but he wanted me to come to that because being single and then two, going into the ministry, that's obviously, that's going to be a big thing that I deal with. And it is. You're constantly dealing with families. And so, yeah. So here's what you have to think about when I meant social skills. So here's what you have to understand. When you look in the Bible, one of the very first statements that you see is God said it was not good for man to be alone. And all throughout the Bible, you see this idea of community. You see this idea of social. In other words, we're made to be social people. We were made for others, and others were made for us. So naturally, this is going to be built into us to be attracted to someone, right? I mean, you eat with your eyes, so you obviously are going to look at somebody and say, he or she is attractive. I think I'd like to ask them out. So we're social creatures.
Yes.
So we're made for community. So that's sort of what I meant. And early on, what Dr. Chapman said and others were saying is it's really sort of unhealthy to just sort of date one person and you know, stay with them and get married. And which I know there's a lot of success stories that are out there.
I mean,
my mom and dad, one of them. I mean, they met in high school and were high school sweethearts and got married. And I mean, so I understand there's a lot of success stories. His point was, not so much what I just said, but it's one of the skills that you're supposed to learn from dating is since we're social people and we were made for others, one of the things we learn from dating is we learn social skills. We learn how to relate to other people of the opposite sex. We learn how to relate to people of different backgrounds, different ethnicities, different personalities.
Yes.
And so that's one of the things we learn. And, you know, here's the thing. When we're teenagers, we've got, like, this much capacity for emotions, but we really only know how to express that much of our emotions. And so we have to learn what are the ways that you do that? By just being around others. And the more social you are, the more you learn yourself and the more you learn others. So I agree with what you said about dating.
Dating, again, you're not, I think there's wisdom in knowing you're not supposed to just jump around from person to person and date whoever with whatever standards and whatever backgrounds. Like, you're supposed to be wise in it. You're supposed to be intentional about it. And you should go into it with the idea that you're trying to date someone that is either at your same level of biblical convictions and standards or above that, like where they hold the same ones and you're equally yoked. But you don't, especially when you're young, you don't always know those things, or they don't even have those established yet. And you can't just go into it saying, like, if I don't know all their convictions or everything about them yet, I can't date them because that means I can't marry them. But that should not be your way to go about that. You should date them to get to know them, to get to know their convictions, and then figure out whether or not you want to move forward. Plus, you're not going to be the best in a relationship if you haven't learned how to interact with a person of the opposite sex one-on-one in a sense of dating. Like, there are some people who are very mature for their age and right. they can start dating at a young age and then they realize, oh, like I actually do know I'm going to marry this person. Usually that's not till years later, but they're able to sustain a long-term relationship for that time. Other people, it's okay if you date someone and it doesn't work out, especially early on, because you are learning things. Every time you date someone and it doesn't work out, you learn more about yourself right. and more about other people and how the world doesn't always revolve around you and your thought processes. Like, everyone thinks differently, but you have to learn how to get used to handling and dealing with people in a peaceful way that think differently than you, yet may still hold your same convictions. So I feel like the church sometimes has gotten this very wrong, and they're like, don't date in high school, don't date ever in college, don't date till you're like almost 30, and just do it if you know you're gonna marry them. And to an extent, they're trying to do it out of protection, because mainly as teenagers, you're not very emotionally mature, so just the way you handle it is more, it does a lot of damage to a person if they date in high school and it doesn't go well, and it could be really heartbreaking. Yet at the same time, like, you don't get to learn those skills just by thinking about it. You have to learn those skills by interacting with people, wouldn't you say? Like, you have to figure that out.
Well, yeah, so, all right, let's do this. Let's start with marriage and back up.
All right.
Okay, so let's start with marriage and back up. Here's what I mean by that. So when I do premarital counseling, the very first session when I work with those that are about to be married, is here's what I tell them, and they're always amazed at the response from the question. Love is not the common denominator in marriage given by the Bible.
No.
As a matter of fact, when we talk about marriage, it says that the husband is to love his wife, but it says the wife is to respect or submit to the husband. So love is not the common denominator. Mm. The common denominator in marriage is commitment. Okay, so hang on. So let's start with marriage, right, and back our way up to sort of learn something about dating. So if commitment is sort of the bond that helps you stay married, which it does, commitment makes your love stronger. Love mm-hmm. doesn't make your commitment stronger.
Yes.
Love is an emotion that comes and goes. Commitment is a character trait that endures no matter what, rich or poor, sickness and health,
yeah.
right? The vows that we make. Okay, so let's take marriage and now back up. So in dating, in learning people, what I'm actually learning to do is I'm learning how to build my own level of commitment.
Yeah.
Because I can look at somebody and go, man, she is just beautiful. And then the more I get to know her, I'm like, wow, I didn't know that about her. Or I don't like it that she smacks when she eats her food. I don't like it that she grows her toenails to 3 inches long. You know what I mean? But, right? And I'm like, I didn't know that about you. You're like, you look beautiful until I saw you in flip-flops. Anyway, I'm just kidding. but you know what I mean, right? And so what happens then? All of a sudden I see a side about you that I don't like, that I don't think I can love. So my commitment's not developed. So what do? Relationship's done. It's over. So what dating does is it helps develop commitment mm-hmm. through social skills. Because here's what you have to understand. One more time, we're social people. We were made for others.
Yeah.
And in the Bible, there's a list of one another's. Love one another, encourage one another, confess to one another, laugh, cry, all of those emotions. So the more that I learn to do that with others, then when God does put that person in front of my life that I eventually do begin to marry, I now have experience in the area of commitment.
That makes sense.
And so that's what you want to do. So yes, you're right. You don't want to just date to date to date to date to bounce around from relationship to relationship. And there are certain ages that I think parents should establish boundaries, guidelines on what it means to date, like at a certain age. You want to encourage social skills among those of the opposite sex. Like, I mean, you want to encourage that among your children. But I think parents should sort of put boundaries on that. Like, maybe yeah. that's just hang out in groups.
Yeah.
You know, like go out in groups of five to 10 kind of a thing at a certain age. And you learn those skills. And then at a certain age, then you start dating. But now you're dating in groups.
Yes.
But you're not dating with the intent of, oh man, she's it or he. You're dating to learn what it means to be social. You're dating to learn what it means to sort of know stuff about yourself. Like you said, dating's not always, the world doesn't revolve around you, but yet in so many relationships, we make that about us. We can come to it with a very consumer mentality, like, what is she or he going to do for me? And then that becomes unhealthy.
Yes.
that viewpoint. So again, I think it's, you know, you need to set boundaries. Parents need to establish boundaries. All this I know is of different ages and age ranges and so forth. And yeah, I guess in the area of where maybe the church, if you say, has gotten it wrong, yes, is when they say you should only date for like a year, and it's only when you know you're going to marry that person. That's sometimes difficult. And I know right now you're probably asking, Pastor Ron, where is it in the Bible that dating is discussed? Well, it's not really. There's not a chapter like many things that are topical. You have to pull from principles, from verses that we have, like I pull from now the book of Genesis, where we talked about man should not be alone. We talked about the marriage, Genesis chapter 2, 24 through 27. Then you have to go into the one another's in the Bible, which are all through the New Testament. But then you have to go into Ephesians chapter 4 on be kind, tender-hearted, forgiving. Mm-hmm. So you have to find all these principles where the Bible tells us how to establish healthy relationships.
Mm-hmm.
Which I think is the next key. I think if you're going to start dating at a certain age, number one, you have to date healthy.
Yes.
Okay, what does that mean to date healthy? Well, that means you have to be healthy. So that's one of the points of hanging out with people of opposite sex, because if you learn those dynamics in groups, and then the groups start getting smaller, and you've whittled it down to, okay, I like him or I like her, then hopefully by that time you've learned enough about yourself and you've learned enough about others and maybe that individual to where you're healthy. Okay, so if we're social people and we're spiritual people, right, then what dating should do and what hanging out with others should do is it should develop us socially.
Yeah.
And it should develop us spiritually, right?
Yes.
And so as I dial into dating a person or whatever, then that person needs to be able to socially help fulfill and develop, and spiritually fulfill and develop.
Yeah, they shouldn't do the opposite.
Right. So I need to be healthy when I date. I need to know that I'm emotionally healthy. I need to know that I'm spiritually, functionally, socially healthy. Now, that doesn't mean you're going to be perfect. I mean, my wife and I have been married, 25 years. We dated for almost 2 years, 18 months or whatever it was before we were married, and so forth. Well, by that time, I was 23. So by that time, I was moderately healthy. So was she. But even then, we still had to work things out. But if we had not had relationships prior to that, if like Raina would have been like the first one, even at 23, that has still been a massive learning curve.
Yes.
Of social skills and spiritual skills and so forth. So again, now you don't date to marry. And here's another topic. I know you know this. I don't believe in missionary dating.
No.
Yeah. If you don't know what missionary dating is, missionary dating is well, I'm a believer, and I'm not as solid in my walk as I'd like to be. I'm not sure if she's a believer, but she has a good heart. She does some good things. I think the longer I'm with her, I can probably bring her over to my side. And then seldom does missionary dating ever work.
No.
Sort of the basics of chemistry kick in here. And the negatives always pull down the positives. Seldom have I ever seen someone who thought they were strong in the faith date someone who they actually knew wasn't even in the faith or knew they were weak in the faith. Seldom, I mean rare, has the chance been that that weaker person actually became stronger. What I've always witnessed is the strong person, the person that claims they're a Christian and a follower of Christ, they actually become weaker.
Yeah.
Because then we start focusing more on the physical side of the relationship, the emotional side of the relationship,
yes,
instead of the spiritual / social. We're social people. We're made for one another. It's not good that we be alone. We were made for community, and we forget often, to develop the social side and the spiritual side because we're just so attracted to them. Again, we eat with our eyes. So, and you want to date somebody you think is attractive.
Yes, please.
That's not what I'm, okay?
But you just have to have boundaries in it. Like, you have to be very wise, because if you date someone purely because they're attractive and you think a side product of dating them will be to grow your spiritual walk, almost every time the physical aspect or the emotional aspect can become really unhealthy really quick. And what I think a lot of young people find is when they become unhealthy in the physical or the emotional area very quick, when they start to realize that the spiritual isn't lining up, they almost feel guilty or pressured to stay in the relationship or guilty to get out of the relationship because they're already so physically and emotionally invested. But if you were to have put that boundary, not a wall, but a boundary up to protect yourself while you're still dating very early on and, you know, still throughout your dating relationship, there should be boundaries. Then if God really speaks to your heart, like, this, they're not aligning with you. They're not equally yoked. This person maybe doesn't work out. Just the way you two blend does not mix very well. There's probably, I have someone out there that's better. I have someone out there that's a better match. You'll be more apt to be obedient if you're not physically involved and emotionally involved, because usually when that happens, it makes it very easy to stay disobedient and stay in an unhealthy relationship when you know everything about the spiritual side is not working out. So boundaries are super important, which is why it just comes back to just date with wisdom, date with intentionality. If you know part of their convictions, then make sure you date someone that has similar convictions for you. But some dating, you can't always just wait to know their convictions before you date them. You have to date them to get to know their convictions. And it's kind of unhealthy to go and hash out, especially on your first date. Like, so how do you feel about blank, 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 and blank? Like, that's heavy stuff to cover. And that has nothing to do with getting to know them as a person. That's just getting to know what convictions God has placed on their heart. And that can be unhealthy in and of itself. So it takes time. But it's so much easier when there's no pressure to say, I have to marry this person if I'm gonna date them. And if it doesn't work out, then that's an embarrassment and it means that I wasn't wise in my dating and that's not good as a Christian. No, like God, you can still be wise in it and be intentional in it while still dating and getting to know yourself, know others, grow spiritually, grow emotionally, and grow socially, but doing it together and doing it without the pressure of, if I'm gonna date this person, especially at my age, that's another huge thing. Like if you're in your 20s and you're like, the next person I'm gonna date has to be my spouse, because I'm getting to the age where like, this is where everybody dates and finds their spouse. So then you put that pressure on it, and if God's like putting that nudge on you of like, no homie, find someone else, you're gonna be more pressured to stay with them, even though it's not as well of an equally yoked situation as God could have intended it to be.
And every time God has said, no homie, I listened. Every time I paid attention to that.
Sometimes that's just how God speaks
to me. He's like, no homie. I'm like, oh, yeah.
He says, nah, man. Yes. And I say, you're right, God. We will actually cut this video in half because we really want to give this the topic, to really expand it in the way it deserves to be expanded. So this is going to be a two-part series. So this is the end of this video. Thank you guys for watching. Do not forget to like and subscribe and be on the lookout for part 2 when the video comes out next week.